So good evening to everybody, and being a host of the program, I am Dr. Virendra Pal, the coordinator of ICTCL of Assam College Librarians Association and the librarian of Koliyabar College. As a host, I welcome you all, and I'd like to go directly to Dr. Devasis Borua, the coordinator of IQAC, for other programs of this webinar. So I'd like to move to Dr. Devasis Borua, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself.
So thank you very much, Dr. Pal. Am I audible to all?
Yeah, sir.
Okay. So it's a very good evening to each and one of you. So on behalf of the Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Farketing College and the whole of the Farketing College fraternity, I welcome all of you to this webinar. Esteemed dignitaries, it's for sure that the recent pandemic of COVID-19 has created an overwhelming, sense of fear, anxiety, and depression all around the globe. The dictates such as staying at home, social distancing, wearing the mask, these are all quite new to us and might be in most of the times difficult for us to cope up with. But there's not an iota of doubt that the caravan of life will always go ahead, move ahead. It might be time for us to accept these changes or this way of new lifestyle and to move forward. Keeping all this in mind, the Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Farketing College has decided to organize this webinar. And I thank the Assam College Librarians Association for their cooperation and support in materializing this event. Now let me introduce our esteemed resource persons today. We have with us Dr. Darshana Lianage from Sri Lanka. Dr. Lianage is a senior lecturer in the Department of Sinhala in the University of Ruhuna, Sri Lanka. He has attended various seminars, workshops, and other such academic programs in various universities on different topics like professional development, creative media writing, peace and social harmony, etc., and has quite a good number of international publications to his credit. He was also a member of the jury of the Sri Lanka Film Critics Forum. We are really honored to have him among us as one of the resource persons. The other resource person we have invited is Padma Shri Patricia Mukim, Madam. Madam Patricia Mukim needs no introduction, actually. She is a versatile writer, a senior journalist of the country, a social activist, who also served as the director of the Indigenous Women's Resource Center, Shillong, Meghalaya. Her areas of special interest are socioeconomic development, rural poverty, and gender issues. She has been invited to several national and international seminars as resource person. She has been conferred with many a prestigious award and has been honored with the Padma Shri, the fourth highest civilian award by the Government of India. Presently, Madam Mukim is the editor of the Shillong Times. We are really privileged to have her amongst us as one of the resource persons. We have with us our principal, Dr. Apurva Khoikia, sir, who is also the chairperson of the Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Farketing College. And we have with us Dr. Prasanta Kumar Deka, librarian, KCDS Commerce College, Guwahati, who is also the General Secretary of the Assam College Librarians Association. And we have with us my co-host, my very good friend, Dr. Birendra Pal, who is the librarian of Koliyabar College and the coordinator of the ICT cell of the Assam College Librarians Association. So now May I request our honorable principal, sir, to present his welcome address. Sir, it's over to you.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Hello, good evening. Good evening, everybody. Respected resource person of this webinar, representatives of Assam College Library Association, esteemed participants, on behalf of Recording College, I welcome you all to this webinar. We all know during last 3 months of this pandemic, our way of thinking, way of life have totally changed. We are in a very new way of life now. This is called the new normal way. This webinar, I think, will highlight how the in the new situation we should cope up, how our actually way of thinking has changed because of the pandemic, and we are all now accustomed to a new situation, and all over the world the number of infected people increasing, as well as number of deaths also increasing, because of which we are under a constant threat. And I personally feel that even after the pandemic, our this new, this normal, this life will be totally different. We are having much nowadays social distancing, hand washing is common everywhere. And even when the pandemic will be over, there will be great change in our life, which we will have to take as a new normal way of life. And our resource person, I think they will highlight all the things. Basically, I think that in this present situation, we should discuss how to make the best use of the time in productively, and how in the present situations, there's different sections of people, mainly students, teachers, administrators, everything, everyone has to change our way of life. I don't want to speak much, and I do believe that the resource persons will discuss in detail everything, every aspect of the topic, and with this few words, I thank the Assam College Library Association for extending their cooperation in organizing this webinar, and my colleagues, IQAC coordinator Dr. Borua, who has taken initiative to organize this webinar. So thanking you all, I conclude my welcome speech. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful welcome address. Now, may I request Dr. Prasanta Kumar Deka, sir, librarian, KCDAS Commerce College, and also the General Secretary of Assam College Librarians Association, to deliver the inaugural speech. Sir, it's over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening. Dr. Pal, am I audible?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay. Honorable Principal, sir, Dr. Apurva Soikha for Recording College, respected resource person, Dr. Darshana Liange, Senior Lecturer, Department of Chinhale University of Wuhan, Sri Lanka, Padma Shri, Madam Patrika Mukhim, writer, activities, editor, the Shillong Times, Shillong Meghalaya, Dr. Devasis Borua, IQAC coordinator, Forgotten College, Dr. Birindu Pal, ICD coordinator, ACLA, respective faculty members, dignitaries, participants from different corner of India, I welcome all of you this wonderful webinar. The normal life of an individual is completely today. The entire country is under lockdown due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And we are aware that all the academic institutions are forced to close down across the country. The society is at great loss. The entire area, it is our responsibility to keep this academic society successful for our future efforts with limited infrastructure. All over the place, online classes, webinars, etc. are organized to reduce our intellectual loss by various school, college, university organization, etc., which are helping us to keeping ourselves busy during this lockdown period. As we all know that COVID-19 has emerged as humanity's crisis that has universally impact almost everything. The uncertainty participating by the pandemic is beyond the statistical estimation. I put the reinstate the normality of the world order are on the progress to the experiments, resources, and cooperation. The ultimate success in the fight against COVID-19 can possibly be just only after the invention of vaccine. In the meantime, the only option is maintain social distancing and follow other preventive strategies. However, during this crucial testing time, we got sufficient opportunity for the innovation and appropriate use of available resource in India. The Ministry of Human Resource Development and UGC directed the higher education institution to use virtual platform for the teaching learning process during this lockdown period. And lockdown has brought several new things to all human beings. Our teachers and students are now continuing e-learning activities. It's true that many institutions don't have the infrastructure and technology landscape for the implementation of the online learning process. The sudden implementation of the same has created a confusion of university among the university and students as well as teachers. Many institutions have not used such measures even after having learning management system and appropriately for the teaching learning process. A larger section of the students who are already at the poverty line is deprived of the hardware and gadget and device assistance. So, and as per a newspaper report, 56% of children have no smartphones for attending online classes. So attending lecture online remains a dream for thousands of students who belonging to the rural and tribal belt of our country and region with minimal internet connectivity infrastructure. Undoubtedly, COVID-19 remains an uncertainty now. Where are the crews yet? How further course of action to be planned for further economic activities? In this regard, blending learning with the online platform can yield a better learning experience for the students. Support in the form of scholarship and assistance to be provided to the sub students for purchasing and assisting electronic devices that facilitates learning in a blended manner. The current crisis we are encountering as a result of COVID-19 should enable the appropriation of the current system of delivery and assessment of the education technology. Education definitely remains essential for the modernization of education in India, generally Assam in particular. At the same time, such efforts should be taken into consideration of socioeconomic factors, including region-specific issues and students' diversity. Otherwise, we cannot think of new normal life in the time of pandemic, basically for the teaching learning process. With this few words, now I declare this international webinar on dealing with the new normal life in the time of pandemic open. Thank you all. Thank you, Binder.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dekha sir, for inaugurating this webinar. Now let us move to the technical session. May I now request respected Dr. Darshana Lianage to make his presentation. Sir, it's over to you, Dr. Lianage.
Thank you, Dr. Barua. Good evening, everybody. First, I would like to thank Dr. Debashish Barua and the organizers of this webinar for inviting me as a resource person. As I have been already asked to speak for 30 minutes, I think I should better directly move to the topic. Okay, let me start by saying few words about the topic itself. The catchword here is the new normal. The new normal. I think we can start from this webinar itself. I think this is a part of the new normal itself. Even before the Zoom was there, no one knew about it. At least many didn't know about it. But in the time of pandemic, now this platform has become a place where thousands of millions of people meet together and conduct seminars. So I think we are in the new normal, and we are dealing with the new normal already in conducting this seminar itself. So let me begin, let me elaborate on what does it mean that there is a new normal. So let me start with the immediate effects that had on the normal we already had been into. So as Dr. Debashish Barua explained, the things like washing our hands and keeping social distance, taking a bath after coming back home from outside, these were not normal earlier. Actually, if you can remember, frequent washing, if someone frequently washes hands, we considered it to be a kind of psychological disorder called OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. You may remember Lady Macbeth, frequent washing of hands. It's a kind of a psychological disorder. So in the earlier normal, we considered it to be a kind of psychological disorder. But in the new normal, we all are doing that. It's like we all are in a kind of mass obsessive compulsive disorder. We all are washing our hands, washing thoroughly. It is for 20 seconds, and with each finger separately, and in between fingers, outside the hands, you know, the rubbing our palms together. Earlier, if someone did so, we will definitely call that person is having a kind of psychological disorder. So think of it, the abnormal has already become the normal in the new scene. What we consider to be abnormal, now we consider it to be normal. So this is the new normal, to understand what is the new normal. So this is something, and when we move into the deeper level, this is surface level. As I said, this is the immediate things, immediate changes that we can observe. But in the long run, we can predict long-term structural changes in our behavioral patterns, in our social relations, in the ways we perceive ourselves and in the ways we perceive the other people, the way we interact with each other. And this will impact on our social relations and our attitudes and our worldviews. Let me compare this with a kind of example. So before COVID-19, we had a kind of virus. What was the virus? That virus was AIDS. We are living with AIDS virus 4 years now. Still, there is no remedy, no vaccine, no whatever for AIDS. So imagine the changes happened after the emergence of AIDS virus. Just imagine the little thing, small things, small changes that the barbershops started using these disposable blades and the boom in the condom market. Those are the changes happened. So in the same way, we should expect changes after COVID-19. The life will not be the same that we are familiar with, that we were familiar with. So that is why we can call it the new normal. It is not that just a catchy word, but I think the normal we have already been into, we are familiar with, will not be there anymore. So we have to adjust with the new normal. So let me, it is like, it will be like this, no? Just think of, can we deny that in the coming years, there will be a boom in the face mask market with colorful and fashionable variables? We can predict it. It can happen. So this is the way the world has changed with the outbreak. Having said that, we are in the new normal already. Now let me elaborate on few points. As I said, as I have been given limited time, I'll be talking on a few points and elaborating on few points. So let me talk on few points on the life in the time of the pandemic. First, how we are dealing with the virus in giving it a meaning. Let me share with you one of my experience with my son. He's in grade 6, and I was helping him with his science textbook. There's a lesson, Wonders of the Living World. So in that text, the things we find in the environment were grouped into two basic categories, living things and non-living things. So he asked me, then what about the virus? I'm not a science expert. I'm not a science expert. I'm from humanities and social sciences. So I made a simple Google search and I found he was correct. A virus is not a living thing or nor a non-living thing. It blurs the binary. It blurs the binary, living, non-living binary. It is a non-living thing, but it has to be dependent on a living organism. So in the way we understand things, in the way the humanities and social sciences people understand things, it's a kind of zombie. It's a kind of living dead. It's a kind of vampire. Okay? It blurs the boundary between living and non-living. So the first reaction is, the first reaction came from the societies is how to make sense of this nonsensical virus. It always, in nature, by natural, we are meaning making animals. We always want to make meaning, and for everything, we need a meaning. When we can't make a meaning, it's a traumatic experience for us. We always want a meaning. So this virus was nonsensical. And so people were trying to make meaning of this virus. That was the first reaction I observed on the net, on news media, and by interacting with the people, the first thing I observed was how people try to make a kind of meaning of this virus. So, when we can't make meaning, when we can't make a meaning for something, when we can't get a meaning, when we can't catch something with our net of meaning, we use kind of alternatives. So when we can't make meanings, what people do is they take a detour to make a kind of understanding of the phenomena, kind of understanding of the thing that they can't make a meaning, that they can't understand. So by doing this, we somehow manage to come up with a story or narrative of that something. If we can't understand something, we take a detour and we make a kind of a story, kind of narrative of that thing. And this helps us to manage with that traumatic experience. So as you know, we can see many such stories or narratives about the coronavirus coming all over the world. Some are scapegoating a particular community or a country. As Donald Trump said, it is China virus or Wuhan virus. In some conspiracy theories, it was made in a lab. In some social media narratives, the virus spreaders belong to particular community. Also, people came up with certain kind of corona philosophies. According to some of them, this is a curse of the nature or a lesson for the humanity, or break for the monotonous and boring life, giving a chance to revitalize the life back. So these are the narratives people came up with. These are the narratives. So all these are kind of detours we have taken to make sense of this nonsensical virus. I'm not interested in talking about whether these are good or bad at this forum, at this talk, but my simple point is that as meaning-making animals, these were the ways we tried to make sense of this nonsensical virus. That is my first point. Moving on to the second, I want to talk on the second point is how the outbreak and consequent new safety measures impacted different cultures. It came like a global warning. So it was like WHO expected that everyone in the world will react in the same way, but it didn't happen. Different cultures reacted, responded in different ways, especially when it comes to social distancing. Although it was introduced as a global health measure, different cultures had to deal with it differently. One American anthropologist, Edward Hall, he distinguishes between contact cultures and non-contact cultures. According to his theory, people in contact cultures tend to stand close together and touch each other when they interact together. But people in non-contact cultures always keep more space between each other and touch each other less in social interaction. So it is obvious that although for non-contact cultures, social distancing was easy to cope with, for contact cultures, for the people in contact cultures, it was a harder struggle. Like, you know, about Assamese culture, I can talk about, I think I lived there for more than 3 years. And I can talk about Sri Lankan culture. We people normally touch each other. chatting or whatever, we when we interact with people, if someone keeps distance, it's like an insult. Okay, it's like you are not welcoming. It's like you are treated as a stranger. So if you come closer, if you come closer, then only I feel that you are inviting me, you are accepting me, and things like that. So these are the differences. For non-contact cultures, we can imagine that for non-contact cultures, social distancing had a kind of different effect than in contact cultures. Also, we could see how the reactions of cultures of individualism differed from the reactions from cultures of collectivism. This is a very, this is my experience, and this is a very important point, I think. So, as some people have suggested, wearing face masks were more accepted in cultures of collectivism than in the cultures of individualism. The reason is that in the cultures of collectivism, people wore face masks not for self-protection, but for the protection of others, to prevent spreading virus to another people, to someone else. I have a personal experience. A few days back, I went to my haircutter. Now here, the government has given it is okay to open these salons and all this. So after a long time, I went to the haircutter. So I went, they are wearing a mask, and it was a very difficult for him to manage with the, when I was wearing mask to cut hair, no? So he asked me, could you please remove the mask? As I am wearing one, you don't have problem, he said. So he was aware that he was wearing the mask not for self-protection, for my protection he was wearing the mask. So this is something that we could we could see, we could.